Greetings from Birmingham, Alabama. Welcome to the 2021 Blazer Hatchery and Hackathon. My name is Rayma Henderson. I'm an entrepreneurship major at the University of Alabama at Birmingham. And on behalf of our university, I'm honored to welcome such a large audience from viewers across the world. Entrepreneurship is my passion. I competed in the inaugural run of this program back in 2019. And let me tell you, if you love entrepreneurship like I do, you're in for an exciting event. Programs like this one instill in young learners strong resilience, the drive required to become an entrepreneur or become a key member of an entrepreneurial company. In my case, I've done both. Right now, I work at Landing, where I'm gaining incredible experiences at one of Alabama's premier entrepreneurial companies. As an entrepreneurship student at UAB, I'm learning concepts that empower me to convey a vision, build a team, raise money, take risk, pivot an organization when necessary, and navigate uncertainty with confidence. Entrepreneurship, though, is not only my passion, it's a passion for all of us here at UAB, and we're excited to share that passion with you. Enjoy the program.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the second annual Blazer Hatchery and Hackathon, coming to you live from Birmingham, Alabama. I'd like to give a special welcome to our worldwide guests. We have people tuning in from India, Rama University in China at Hua Chao University, across Europe, Ukraine, and across the USA. A special shout out to everybody at UAB, in the business school, the medical school, the president's office, and everyone else who has supported us for this event. Let me tell you a little bit about this event and what we're going to do tonight. So this is one of our premier events in the UAB Entrepreneurship Program. It's designed to take students at UAB who are not yet entrepreneurs, but who would really like to be entrepreneurs, and give them an experience that feels a lot like entrepreneurship. So we take them from the medical school and from sociology and social sciences and psychology, all the different programs that you can imagine. So there's great diversity in the talent you're going to see tonight, but they're united by a passion for entrepreneurship, but they're just not yet entrepreneurs. So we give them a really intense training session for 2 weeks in the entrepreneurial mindset, and then our sponsors, the Alabama Power Foundation, have presented them with a challenge, an ill-defined challenge that you'll learn more about a little bit later. And then we started a hackathon where the teams work together just like entrepreneurial teams would, and they come up with innovative solutions to the grand challenge with which they've been. Tonight you're going to have five teams. They're going to be presenting a panel. The panel will have a deliberation period to ease the tension a little bit. I think it'll be a lot of fun. Everybody will. And there will also be a viewer's choice award where the audience menu survey will pop up on your screen and you'll be able to click and select the team that you thought deserved to win. And they'll be getting a special prize as well. And now it's my honor to introduce our MC for tonight's program. Eunice Elliott is well known here in our state, in Alabama, around the region, and across the country. She is a TV personality, she's an author, she's a comedian. She was our MC when we had this event for the first time in 2019, and she is phenomenal. She brings a lot of energy, she's an entrepreneur herself, and what she's going to do is carry us through the five team pitches. And so wherever you are in the world watching right now, please give a warm welcome, and everybody here in the room, please give a very warm welcome to Miss Eunice Elliott. Thank you, and enjoy the program.
Thank you so much, Dr. Murphy, for having me back. I did get a chance to participate in this wonderful event in 2019, and I remember Rima, and I'm so excited to see how much more she has blossomed. She was a rock star back then already. Now, as Dr. Murphy mentioned, I am an entrepreneur myself. It depends on the day. Some days I wake up and I feel like an entrepreneur. Other days I wake up and I feel unemployed. So today, I feel pretty successful because I'm here with a lot of great young minds, and I'm excited to present them to you this evening. There is a wonderful nervous energy and excitement, and even though they may not be officially entrepreneurs right now, they are competing for real-life cash money. So make sure you send wonderful energy and vibes to our teams as they come up and present this evening before our panel of judges. So are the teams ready?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll take that as a yes. They don't have a choice. All right, team number one, Steel City Harvesters, an urban farm serving historically excluded communities. Take it away.
Yeah. Here you go.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Lane Lambert, and I'm here with Steel City Harvest, Birmingham's newest social enterprise. Steel City Harvest is focusing on the lasting impacts of white flight in the city of Birmingham. Birmingham lost just under 50% of its population during the Civil Rights Movement. This left thousands of vacant lots in the city, the supermarkets left with the people following the wealth out of the city. Nowadays, 70% of Birmingham is located inside of a food desert. While many people see this as a tragedy, we see it as an opportunity for change in the city. I'm with Chief Harvester Brian, and what is the opportunities for change in the city of Birmingham?
While many see these vacant lots as empty, we see them as full of opportunities to not only change the perceptions of our neighborhoods, but to also plant the crop of the future. We've seen it be done successfully in other communities across this nation, where inspired social entrepreneurs take vacant lots in their communities and transform them into community gardens. And we believe we can do the same thing here, as we believe we also have the support of the community, because about an hour to 2 hours ago, we were over in Ensley polling our constituents, asking them their thoughts on community gardens. And we received overwhelming support for the idea and how they believed it would create a positive impact for their communities. And so what we will do is we transform these vacant lots into outdoor hydroponic gardens that, by the way, produce 30% more produce while using 90% less water than traditional farming techniques. This allows us to sell our produce at local farmers markets and local farm-to-table restaurants. And we believe these farm-to-table restaurants will be very supportive of our business because it's a unique, one-of-a-kind farm located in the inner city limits as opposed to traditional competitors located dozens of miles away out of the city. And a part of our business is to partner with Birmingham City Schools to educate at-risk high school students on the social entrepreneurship aspects of urban farming. And we even take a select few of these extremely passionate students and make them employees of Steel City Harvest to let them really go full force with their passion of urban farming.
Thank you, Brian. So can you clarify for me, what makes you a social enterprise versus a more traditional business?
Well, we do have our commercial side of the business, which is the selling to local farmers markets and the local farm-to-table restaurants. We also have a part of our business model that is strongly tied to our mission. And part of the mission is, you know, eradicating food deserts. And the way we do this is we sell our produce at below market rates to community members located in these food deserts.
Thank you. So just so I have it clear, Steel City Harvest wants to go into these communities with vacant lots and start hydroponic farming in them. Then they want to use local high school students to run the farms and teach them values of entrepreneurship. And then they're going to sell this back to the community at cost and to markets such as Pepper Place and local farm-to-table restaurants to generate a profit.
You hit it on the nail, Layton. Good job.
Okay, so Chief Harvester Reed, how do you plan to change the perception of Ensley as a whole and communities like it?
Well, imagine driving through Ensley today, and right now you see a beautiful house that's well-maintained, but right beside it is a vacant lot that's been overgrown, that's been abandoned for years. What we're doing is we're buying that vacant lot at discount rates through an already established program of Birmingham, Adopt a Lot, and we're gonna be revitalizing it into a beautiful garden that will inspire others to go out and create their own garden. And so that's how we're gonna be changing the perception of Ensley.
Well, that sounds beautiful, Brian. Now, what is your impact? So your total impact of Birmingham and the community as a whole and outside the city?
Well, we don't want to limit ourselves to just Ensley. We want to grow and to eradicate food deserts all across Birmingham, since 70% of Birmingham is currently in a food desert. And so our goal is to eradicate food deserts in Birmingham and beyond. And we're going to be doing this by expanding our business into other vacant lots and other underserved communities across Birmingham. And not only that, but through training these local high school students, they'll be, when they graduate, they can go out and start their own urban farm. And so we're going to be expanding our mission to wherever they may go. They may go to other countries and they can create their own urban urban farm there. And so we're expanding our mission beyond Birmingham, and we want to be a forge for good in Birmingham and beyond.
Great job. Wonderful concept, historical background. And if that young man does not have a future in urban farming, I can see him on 60 Minutes. Great interviewing. Great job. It's like he already knew the answers, almost. All right, we're ready for it. Well, let me check. Is team number two ready? Okay, team number two is ready. We are now going to hear a presentation from Genesis Birmingham. This is an after-school program that instills curiosity and purpose in youth to bring generational change to the city of Birmingham. Take it away.
I'm Drew, and I researched how we would collaborate with the local schools and developed our website, genesisbirmingham.org.
Good evening. My name is Brittany. I did the research on the historical background of the city of Birmingham, and I also took the lead on the mission statement.
Hello, everyone. My name is Nathan. I was in charge of researching financial logistics, and I also did the graphic designs.
I'm Dulce, and I researched the operational logistics for Genesis.
Hi, my name is Sarah. I was the team lead of Genesis Birmingham, and I was responsible for developing the curriculum and for researching partners.
Be honest, do you think of the Pythagorean theorem when you're filing your taxes? 1 in 2 high school graduates say that the educational system did not equip them with real life skills, and 1 in 3 people live in poverty in Birmingham. The lack of practical education and the cycle of poverty are rooted in the unequal distribution of resources due to the generational effects of redlining and segregation. So how can we revitalize Birmingham's educational system to create a cycle of wealth for the youth of Birmingham? And we will take the youth, and then we will have curiosity, autonomy, and purpose.
We will achieve this empowerment through our progressive approach to education. I'll now take you through our elementary curriculum in order for you to gain a more holistic view of our program. So it starts at 3. We bring students from the surrounding schools to our facility where they'll socialize and they'll share a meal from local farmers. They'll be able to study and understand this meal more. And then whenever we move into our activities, we'll have six major categories. So this could be like financial literacy or environmental stewardship or even home ec. However, we don't expect our students to want to learn how to, you know, file taxes or write a check yet. So we lay a framework for this so they can develop related skills that are more appropriate for their age. And then we create a foundation based on curiosity and creativity and determination for these students using the Montessori method. We use a lot of independently guided activities and collaborative play and also hands-on learning. So for instance, if a student wanted to learn how to build circuitry, we could work with them to play with LED lights in a breadboard. Or if they wanted to learn about the environment, that they could build an ecosystem in a small little Coke bottle there. And then at the end of the day, we have fun physical activities that could combat the lacking and reducing recess time during traditional school hours. Because at Genesis, we truly care about the social and the emotional and the physical health of our kids.
Thank you. Our facility will be located in southern Birmingham to be in close proximity to institution that will be serving. Our workforce will consist of volunteers, interns with an interest in child development, and employees that will come together to cultivate an engaging experience for these students. The students that are benefiting from our program are welcome back to be a part of the experience for other students as well. To alleviate the stress of carpooling, Genesis will provide transportation for the students to our facility that will be equipped with a space for learning.
So, how do we take our program and make a viable venture out of it? Well, the demand for after-school programs in Alabama is extremely high. For every spot in a program, there are 4 students waiting to take their spot in line. So, what'll it cost? Our overhead costs include the facility maintenance, the essential staff salary, and the food. This is coupled with the initial startup cost of the facility and the educational equipment. So how do we cover that? Our revenue will initially be raised through investments and grants. Birmingham offers the BOLD grant, which is a grant specifically for small businesses who innovate in education and childcare and covers up to 80% of the project cost. The remaining 20% will be sought from investors here in Birmingham who align with our mission. Long-term profits come from monthly fees competitively priced, as well as potential partnerships with the City of Birmingham and individual schools. So, of course, to get this program off the ground, we want to partner with local organizations who align with our mission, as well as have the infrastructure to support it. So we've already gotten in contact with Booker T. Washington Elementary and Jones Valley Elementary, who have already expressed interest in partnership. Additionally, Altec, a resource, an organization based on trade, is interested in investment and partnership. And additionally, we want to be able to measure our impact in the Birmingham community. To that end, qualitatively, we want to work with people and get their feedback and testimonial, as a social enterprise is measured by its impact on people. Quantitatively, we want to measure kids' journey through Genesis and beyond by measuring key metrics such as graduation rate, career choice, and eventually middle class growth in Birmingham. In conclusion, Genesis Birmingham is a visionary program designed to instill curiosity, autonomy, and purpose in today's youth. And of course, it's our duty to make sure that the Birmingham's youth of today have the tools they need to succeed tomorrow. Thank you.
Another wonderful presentation from Genesis Birmingham. Congratulations on that. When she said you don't think of the Pythagorean theorem when I'm doing my taxes, if you become an entrepreneur, it's pretty much the same thing. A lot of 1099s to figuring that thing out. All right, is team number three ready? All right, bringing to the stage Steal the Magic City, an application platform that enables community members to experience Birmingham's rich history in a positive way.
It's the YouTube. Second one. Has anyone ever stopped to consider what makes Birmingham so special? Hello, everyone. My name is Krishna Patel, team leader of Steal the Magic City. We started with an emerging problem. How do we educate the community while engaging the community on what makes Birmingham so special? So that's when we came up with Steal the Magic City. Steal the Magic City is an application platform that allows users to engage in Birmingham's rich history in a positive way. So here's how it works. QR codes are placed all throughout the city in Birmingham's most historic sites. Users then set off to find those codes. After finding and scanning those codes, users can then redeem them for prizes. For example, let's say I find two codes. I can then redeem those two codes at one of our sponsors at Thurges Barbershop, or I can save up to 10 codes to get $25 worth of gas and from our sponsors at Dotson Oil. And here's what three of the clues from one of our most notable sites look like at Kelly Ingram Park. Clue number one, at the age of 10, Ron Buford, now top executive at Alabama Power, hid behind trees in this park to avoid high-pressure hoses. And clue number two would lead the player to the exact placement within the park. So, for example, clue number two, the view from the code. Are you afraid of Jill? This is to highlight the significance of the monument. Clue number three would lead the player to the exact placement of the QR code. There are three clues per QR code per location, and they change every month to actively engage users.
Well, it's only been 3 months since I moved here across the ocean. Well, I'm Joel Wickle. As my friend Krishna shared about what exactly the app is, so I'm moving forward towards explaining the name, why we select this name, Steal the Magic City. As being an international student from India, which is a very cultural country, I was super excited in exploring Birmingham's rich history and culture. As we got to know more about it, as Birmingham City has been known as the Iron City of the United States because it has the biggest and oldest iron industry. which was the major reason of us selecting this name. Our main motivation of launching and designing this app is to connect the community with the local businesses and the historic places, which is the heart and soul of the city. Well, I know she is thinking, like, how does this exactly help the local businesses? But it's like, as you shared, all the challenges are incorporated in such a way that people collect the QR codes, complete the challenges, collect the points, and they can redeem it with our partnered local businesses in the form of freebies and discount codes. And guess what? We have already got 26 local businesses backing us as sponsors and who are even ready to write us the checks on the spot. And plus, we are already attracting international sponsors from India too, who are ready to invest in our app. And that's how we know we are moving in the right direction.
Well, hello everyone. My name is Victor Boyd. And I think Steal the Magic City will be a great addition to Birmingham's cultural and entertainment industries. Our goal is to engage the community by creating a game that brings people together, supports small businesses, and showcases the incredible culture of Birmingham. Now, the community's lack of knowledge of the history of Birmingham is what brought forth the idea of Steal the Magic City. And our mission to present the legacy of Birmingham will continue to evolve as we later incorporate more historical sites into our game. Our operation is essential and influential as we promote family engagement and create a more educated community.
Hello everyone, my name is Shantice, the team's creative visionary. I'm excited for the future of our social enterprise because we will introduce a range of initiatives that will both impact the community and transform Birmingham's negative perspective in a positive way to remind our community that we are still the Magic City.
Wonderful, wonderful job from Steal the Magic City. I was sitting there, how many different ways can you say steal? The Magic City. Steal the Magic City. Don't steal the Magic City. All right. Great job, congrats. All right, team number four, are you ready? Okay, they're quiet, but they're ready. Team number four is Iron City Experiences, an application platform that uses current attractions to showcase history and deliver immersive experiences that transform how community members see. Giving the stage over to Iron City Experiences.
Good evening. My name is Whitney Walker, and I'm the Marketing Director for Iron City Experiences. Birmingham is plagued with an image that it hasn't changed since the Civil Rights era. The belief that Birmingham hasn't changed, mixed with bad news, reinforces the idea that Birmingham can't change. We took a survey with a sample size of 150 participants, and we found that 58% of people had a negative perception of Birmingham. Our image is that our city is not safe, lacks attractions, and are not tolerant of diversity. Our mission is to inspire the belief that Birmingham has changed, is open to change, and can be a leader in social progress. We spoke with multiple businesses who are interested in partnering with us and that believe in our mission. I would now like to discuss with you our opportunities and resources. There are 146 properties and districts listed on the National Register in Birmingham, including three National Historic Landmarks. Visitors spent an estimated $1.9 billion in the Greater Birmingham area in 2017. We have created an app which is designed to change the perception on how our users view Birmingham. By using our current attractions to showcase our history, We believe that we will make a lasting impact on how our users view Birmingham. We took a business impact assessment, which evaluated our social impact along with multiple key dimensions, and we were found to be certified, to be eligible, to be a B Corp.
My name is Trace Martin, data analyst for Iron City Experiences. Our app will provide a platform for users to explore all that Birmingham has to offer. Based on interest and interaction with our app, users build routes to explore Birmingham in a new way. For example, if you wanted to visit 16th Street Baptist Church, you would locate it on the map and then add it to your route. Once you add that to your route, you can begin adding more things to it. Like if you wanted to finish off the night with a nice meal at El Barrio, you will then add that to your route. Once you finish your route guide, you will hit Start Route and begin your journey. After a user has visited the site, they will be prompted to take a survey. This is how we track the effectiveness of our platform in changing the perception of Birmingham.
My name is John Wise, and I'm the director of Iron City Experiences. We believe that as our customers learn about Birmingham's history, they should be rewarded. As our users explore Birmingham's historic landmarks, they earn a cryptocurrency called Iron City Cash, which they can then use in exchange for goods and services at local businesses. A business can then use Iron City Cash as a sales tax credit. The local government is incentivized to allow the sales tax credit by a measurable improvement in Birmingham's perception, an increase in tourism, and an increase in business sales. Our revenue stream is generated by businesses paying us 20% of what they save in sales tax. For example, if a business earns $1,000 in Iron City Cash, they pay us $200 and are then able to save $800 that they would have had to pay in sales tax. We believe that Birmingham's history is a source of power which can change the minds of generations. But we do not believe that the work is done yet, so we're looking to broaden our constituency in order to bring our app to market. We invite you to come alongside of us, join our mission in changing Birmingham's future. Come experience Birmingham with us.
Great job, Iron City Experiences. I got the wardrobe memo, but not the t-shirt. So somebody get me my t-shirt. All right, we are down to our final team. Is team number 5 ready? Yes, yes, yes. Okay, this is RE Forum, an innovative e-waste recycling venture that offers previously incarcerated individuals employment opportunities and a professional boot camp training program. Take it away, RE Forum.
Hello, everyone. My name is Neha Mulchandani. It's been a privilege to be a team leader of this amazing and brilliant group of individuals right behind me. We're honored to have an MBHS student with us, Woody Phipps. I'm a computer science undergraduate major, and my passions lie in cybersecurity, fintech, and cloud computing.
Hi, I'm Woody Phipps. I go to Mountain Brook High School, and I plan to go to Auburn next year to study in building science.
Hi, my name is Corey Walker. I'm a digital marketing student, passionate about all things marketing and tech.
Hi, my name is Julia Otto. I'm a business major and I aspire to be an entrepreneur.
My name is Des Biddle and I'm an undergrad computer science student. Before we begin, I would like to share with you a very personal story that revolves around the reason that we have decided to continue with this venture. My aunt recently passed away in 2020 after being incarcerated on and off over 20 years. In that time, she lacked the available resources, community support, and employment opportunities to succeed. However, within this, there is so much reason and so much necessity for change, and we can provide that today.
Here in Alabama, 1 out of 3 released prisoners reoffend within 3 years. This pattern is known as recidivism. The Alabama Department of Corrections stated that lack of employment options and community support for released convicts is a major factor of recidivism. However, there is opportunity for change. Birmingham recently hit the charts as the second fastest developing tech hub, but with innovation comes many things left behind, such as discarded electronic products called e-waste. Each individual in the US generates about 46 pounds of e-waste, and only 6 pounds are being recycled. E-waste is harmful to our environment as lead and mercury leach into our land and water. And at this point, you're probably wondering how the prison system and e-waste are related. That's where reform comes in. R for reducing recidivism rates, E by providing employment within our e-waste facility, and reform as we reform employment opportunities.
Reform success is measured by our triple bottom line: people, planet, and profit. We are putting people first by employing them at our state-of-the-art facility that is R2 Safe Recycling certified. Second, planet. We will take this e-waste, transforming the pollution problem within Birmingham and using the e-waste to our own advantage. Finally comes profit. Our facility will tap into discarded, disintegrated tech, transforming it into hard cash, taking advantage of a $7.5 billion domestic market. This is an industry that can only grow from here as tech becomes more and more outdated, quicker and quicker through new innovation within Birmingham. However, our corporate goal remains the same: to make sure that recycling is accessible to everybody within the community. And we are going to do this by placing drop-off bins all around the city in high traffic areas like your coffee shop, your grocery store, and your outlet mall. Every piece of e-waste recycled within our facility is going to make sure that Birmingham stays cleaner as a city.
Putting people first. Reform is focused on creating endless opportunities for previously incarcerated individuals, also known as PIIs. We recognize this is a valuable demographic, as over 95% of these individuals will eventually be released, with nowhere to turn, from family to income to career. To combat this, not only are we providing them opportunities within our e-waste facility, but we've created a boot camp program that focuses on a variety of courses from artificial intelligence, data analytics, and cybersecurity. Together, we believe that we can make a difference. Innovate Birmingham, a local company based off of Birmingham, believes that our implementation would be a game changer, providing education and employment opportunities are in one. We hope to partner with them as a part of our mission.
We plan to lower recidivism by providing secure employment along with offering courses teaching highly desirable tech skills. But we cannot do this without first starting out as an LLC to provide a proof of concept for our e-waste facility. Now, once sustainable profitability is reached, we will then reach out to Birmingham's Offender Alumni Association to hire PIIs. From there, we will apply for our B Corp status, honoring our triple bottom line: people, planet, and profit.
We utilize these three P's. We utilize these three P's to balance social enterprise and profitability. By placing our employee PIIs at the forefront of our B Corp, we're able to give them, equip them with relevant tech skills. We're able to give them a way to positively impact their community, as well as a way to really contribute to the much needed tech talent in Birmingham. On top of that, we've created an e-waste facility that will be that will serve as a positive force within the environment, keeping billions of dollars worth of e-waste out of our environment every year. In our implementation, we take this e-waste, we process it, and we sell all the valuable parts for profit. Reform has all the resources in place, we have all the talent, and we have the city for it. We can make this a success with you in the audience. With that, I think that it is so important that we continue to have these conversations about how we can tap into Birmingham's rich history as an innovative steel manufacturer and our potential as a tech powerhouse in the southeastern region. With that, Reform would like to thank you for your time and consideration. Thank you, everyone.
Great job, Reform. I'm always excited to be a part of this event because it's exciting to see these young minds collaborate and come up with these amazing ideas that are so viable. The young man is in high school on that team, so he might I'm just telling you, you might think he wants to get into entrepreneurship, but he has that politician hand down already. Did you know that he has he had this one going, so he might have a career in office. So I want to congratulate all five teams again. Give it up for Steel City Harvesters, Genesis Birmingham, Steel the Magic City, Iron City Experiences, and RE Form. Great job. Great job to all of you. So now it's my honor and privilege to bring back the reason I'm here, Dr. Murphy.
All right, everybody, I hope you enjoyed that. We have a lot of people viewing online. That was fantastic. The judges were taking notes. They're about to go into their deliberation, and you, the viewers, are about to have a survey pop up on your screen where you can vote for the ones that you thought were the best. I'd like to introduce somebody now who's very special. So I've lived in Birmingham for 3 years, and we've built an amazing entrepreneurship program at the University of Alabama at Birmingham. We're one of very few schools in the country and in the state who have an entrepreneurship undergraduate major. It's only 15 months old, and we're approaching 100 students, 100 declared majors. The growth has been meteoric, and I think the passion that you saw in these young aspiring entrepreneurs tonight is we're on the cusp of a sea change. There's a lot of entrepreneurial energy in the incoming generation right now, and we're building a program to teach them, to give them the tools that they need to build careers that make an impact and make good lives for them and their families. It's very important to us, and we couldn't do it without the support of community partners. And the gentleman I'm going to introduce to you right now was with us from the very start. He's been with us for 3 years. He is assistant treasurer at Alabama Power, which is our major public utility, our electric company here. And he also works with the Alabama Power Foundation, who are the generous sponsors of this event tonight. And they came up with the theme that we used, which is all about Birmingham and benefit corporations. It's very meaningful to them. It's very meaningful to our younger generation. And they're supporting us with their financial resources, their expertise, their network. And as I say, we couldn't do it without them. So I'm going to let Chris Blake come up and tell you a little bit about their vision, their mission, and their purpose. And then he's on the judging panel, too. So then they're going to go deliberate, and he'll introduce our special guest. But Chris, please.
All right. Good evening, everyone. Glad to be here. Thanks, Patrick, for the generous introduction. As a UAB alumni, I'm always excited to participate in this event, and as the foundation, we are excited to sponsor this event. You know, the foundation's been around since 1989, and we've been we've had the ability to give more than $250 million back to the communities here in the state of Alabama, so we're very excited about that. And we hope that through all that, that the foundation has been a force for good in the communities that we participate in, you know, providing grants to educational opportunities, to the arts, to the environmental opportunities, as well as to the health and human services. And recently, we've really started to change our focus and be more strategic and focused on impact investing. Providing low-cost loans to certain organizations to further nonprofit purposes. We've also tried to get into collaborative impact, so connecting nonprofits with agencies and other resources around to help them do their missions even better than they were before. And also trying to, hopefully a lot of this will end up in economic empowerment. And we've really focused in, you know, on social and societal issues this year, especially B Corps, which has been part of the focus here. And so it's been really exciting to see a lot of these come to fruition here tonight and to hear these groups. And so we definitely have our work cut out for us as judges to figure out our winners. And, you know, so we're going to have to get busy on that. So without any further ado, I want to bring up our entertainment for the evening as we go do our collaboration. So we have a comedian here for us, Carlos Rodriguez. He is a regular in Atlanta at the Punchline, and hopefully he will be able to entertain you while we go do some work. So without further ado, Carlos, come on up.
Thank you. Wow. Thank you so much. I just want to say it was very impressive to seeing young folks like yourself have that kind of confidence and try to make changes, positive changes in the world. So if you can, just give these young people another round of applause, please. That was very impressive. Oh, yeah, I wouldn't have been able to do that when I was that age. I was in the Navy. I was in the Navy for a while. I was a dental tech. This is way more fun than my day job. I guess I should just, I'm a dental hygienist, 9 to 5. That's what I do. And silence and disbelief, that is the proper response. I know I look like security at Walmart. I know what I look like. Somebody told me I look like if Vin Diesel and Pitbull had a love child and overfed them. And I'm like, wow, that's incredible. And it's incredible. I don't know. I just Walmart. It's one of those places where I think they want you to steal. They put the oldest guy at the door, and I'm not very fast anymore, but I can outrun Earl. You know, if I make it to the car, it's my stuff. That's a little game I like to play with the folks at Walmart. And this is kind of weird for me, guys. This is it's kind of like an audience, but not really. You know. I really am hygienist, if anybody cares. I know I don't look like one. And I had a lady come in the other day. She's like, where's my regular girl? And I'm like, I don't know. She's on vacation. You got Carlos the hygienist today, which I get it. It doesn't sound legit to me either, but I got a name tag and scrubs that kind of sort of fit. So open wide. Let's just get uncomfortable. And I go, what's the problem? She's like, I've never seen a male hygienist before. I'm like, that's because you're mispronouncing it, ma'am. And then she goes, listen, I got to know. And this is where things get worse. She goes, you're not homosexual, right? I go, wow, that's incredibly rude. It has nothing to do with anything. And no, I'm not, for the record. I'm not. My husband is. But I'm not. I don't know. I almost didn't make it tonight, guys. I got into a little fender bender. I had to get a rental car at Enterprise. Anybody ever run a car with Enterprise? It's a horrible organization. And this is just my experience. Every time I go, they lose my reservation. I'm like, and it happened again. I'm like, how does this keep happening? She's like, I don't know, sir, but we're going to make it up to you. We're going to get you a free upgrade to an SUV. What do you think? And I'm like, no. Drive all over the Southeast. You're going to kill me in gas. And she goes, it's a small one. You're going to love it. It's a Hyundai Tucson. Tucson, really? You mean Tucson? She goes, Tucson? Is that how you say it? I'm like, yeah. She goes, what's a Tucson? I'm like, are you kidding me? It's a city in Arizona. It's right next to Phoenix. Which you need to get hooked on, evidently. Now hurry up and give me the keys to the Tucson. I got to go to Knoxville tomorrow night. See, because it was Phoenix and I wasn't. You guys are smarter than this, guys. Come on. Guys worried about winning. I get it, man. I try to be a winner too. Not very successfully, but I try. I try. I'm married. Sorry. I was completely safe here, just for the record. I was completely safe. 31 years, guys. I'm serving life. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I was 20. When we got married, 20. What do you know at 20? Nothing. You don't know how about, sir, is that your missus? How long have you guys been? 22. 22, that's a great answer. Yeah. What's her favorite color? You better have all that information ready to go, sir. Don't mess around. And, but we've been married a long time. My wife, like 31 years is a long time. And have a couple adult children. I have a son who's 25, and my daughter's 29. She's a physician. She's a doctor. You know, my son is not. Might be going to prison, but still, you know, it's just there's a program that'll help him when he gets out. That's, you know, I'm kidding. He's not that bad. He's just a boy. He's not as focused as his sister, and you know, it is what it is, guys. It is what it is. But you know, 31 years, it's a long time. The other day we're driving home from dinner, and I'm always clowning around. I never stop, right? It must have just rained. The road is real foggy. And I go, what if we hit something and we think it's a deer, but it's not. It turns out it's a unicorn. She goes, that is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Don't talk to me. And I'm like, just hear me out. Unicorns are magical. You can't kill it. I would just drag him to the side of the road. He'd be so grateful. He granted us two wishes. What would you do with your wish? She goes, I wish I had a husband that didn't believe in unicorns. That's what I wish. And I giggle all the way home like an idiot because she's upset over an accident that didn't happen on a thing that doesn't exist. It's a non-issue. She's a hater, bro. She doesn't like the stand-up. She doesn't. Like, I bought a dream catcher and I put it over my side of the bed and she cut all the strings out. That's just negativity right there. That's love to death. I'm not going anywhere because, let's be honest, I don't have options, right? This is what commitment looks like, ladies. This is coming home at 7 o'clock every night. Now she's a nurse. She works nights. I think she's a nurse. I'm not really sure where she goes. It's none of my business, really. I don't ask too many questions, you know. And she's been doing this lately. I don't know, long-term relationships. You guys are probably focused on school and making it big and that type of thing. I get it. Take your time. Don't rush, you know. But I was 20, like I said. This is probably not the smartest thing I ever did. But it worked out, you know, 31 years. And lost my track of thought. She's an animal lover, guys. We have a bunch of pets at our house. Pets? Pet lovers?
Yeah.
Yeah, who isn't, right? So if you're not, something might be wrong with you, you know? She has a pet rat, you know, which is kind of weird, right? She walks around with it on her shoulder. She's like, hey, what do you think? I'm like, no, it's just creepy. I go, if you're not in the mood, just say so. That is... Wrong demographic. I forgot who I was talking to. You got it, right? Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. We have a sugar glider. Sugar glider, which sounds like lotion for diabetics, but it's not. It's a little flying squirrel. And he's horrible at flying. Like, he hits the back of the couch. And I'm like, Lance, dude, but contacts cost too much. We took his pilot's license and not let him fly anymore. We have three dogs. Cocoa Butter and Snickers, almost like a heavy person named them, huh? And Snickers is a, and they're all rescues. Rescue's a strong word. I didn't rescue them from anything. I just, you know, got them free on Friday at the pound. I just, you know, and but Snickers is, she's a Chihuahua mixed with a Basset Hound. It's kind of crazy, right? Butter is a miniature pincher, and Coco is a serial killer, I think. I think she's a big, old, rough-looking dog, man. And we had two guinea pigs, too. Had, in the past tense. A couple weeks ago, my wife comes up to me. She goes, listen, Peanut's losing weight. We had two of them, Peanut and Pumpkin, right? She goes, Peanut's losing weight. And I'm like, how do you know he's losing weight? She's like, he feels a little skinny. He feels a little bony. I'm like, okay. And I go, what do you want to do? She goes, I want to take him to a vet. I'm like, there's a vet for guinea pigs? She's like, yeah. I go, that sounds like a specialist. How much is this going to cost? And she goes, it's $75 for the exam. I go, a new guinea pig's 30. It's 2.5 guinea pigs, am I right?
Yeah.
I go, why don't you just turn around and I'll do what we need to do, and I'll run out to PetSmart. I'll bring you a brand new baby bear. You call him Walnut. I don't care. She goes, we're not doing that. We're taking him in. So my son takes him in, and I go, what's the damage? He goes, dude, you're not going to like it. It's about $400. I'm like, for what? He goes, his teeth got too long from eating soft foods. They're going to sedate him and shave his teeth down. I'm like, he's getting Invisalign? What are you talking about? I go, you know your boy's a hygienist, right? To grab the Tito's and the toenail clippers and let's work a little frontier medicine on the kitchen table, dude, you know? We're not doing that. We're taking them in. So all weekend, I got to feed him guinea pig protein powder smoothie nonsense mix because he can't chew, you know? Tuesday morning rolls around. My son takes him in. I don't hear anything. I call him around lunchtime. I'm like, dude, how's Peanut? And he goes, shh, he's in recovery. He's in recovery. It's not grandpa with a heart valve. It's a fancy tailless rat. I'm a Puerto Rican dude from New Jersey. We didn't have pet rodents growing up. I mean, they were there, freelancing. but they didn't clock in, you know? Unbelievable, man. I'm like, whatever. So I get home, and we have like a corral, and there's two little huts and pumpkins in one. He comes out, he comes strutting out, he's all fat and juicy and orange, right? Like a wrestler from the 80s, you know what I'm talking about? And then Peanut comes out, and he looked pathetic, dude. His head was bandaged up like a Civil War soldier. They made him a splint out of popsicle sticks. He was limping a little bit. They shaved him from the neck down. He's all pink and veiny. I was like, oh my God, but you okay, man? Are you cold? What's cut a sock when, and I made him a little jacket. I was like, how was that, Peanut? He was like, it was horrible, Dad. It was horrible. I was like, I'm sorry, buddy. I'm sorry. We fist bump. I let him go to sleep. I go to bed. I go to check on him the next morning before I leave for work. He didn't make it through the night, guys. I know. No one's more upset than me. $400, right? $400, guys. Four bills. That's ridiculous, man. What kind of hustle are they running here? That's 13 guinea pigs before tax. Am I right? It's a lifetime worth of guinea pig ownership, folks. First real money I make off this comedy game, I'm going out and buying a baker's dozen worth of guinea pigs and training them in an intensive boot camp to break into this lady's vet's office and bite her in the ankles. That's what we're going to do. Rest in peace, Peanut. Rest in peace. Wow. It's quiet in here, guys. I'm bombing so hard right now. I'm going to get a visit from the FBI when this is over. You know what's funny? I just recorded a comedy special 2 weeks ago. Yeah, joke's on me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, my gosh. Did I tell you about the car accident, the Tucson? Did we talk about that? I'll say this, man. 2020 was a rough year. Transitional in many, transformative in a lot of ways. Am I right? You know, we lost some people. Things were tough. It wasn't horrible for everybody. I mean, as a bigger guy, if it took a pandemic for me to get a little bit of extra elbow room on a flight, I'm going to roll that dice every time. Come on, guys. We're just jokes. Relax, all right? I've changed my perspective. 2019, Father's Day. It's a Saturday night. Father's Day Sunday, of course, but the Saturday night before. I'm performing at a theater in Lawrenceville, Georgia, having a great time. I was murdering and dying at the same time, guys. I broke out in a cold sweat, heavy, suspicious amount, like R. Kelly standing outside of a high school, like a guilty amount of sweat, you know? A guilty amount of sweat. And turns out I was in the beginning stages of having a heart attack on stage, guys. True story. I was in such denial that I leave the show after I finish the show like a lunatic because I'm a monkey. I got to perform. You know what I mean? And I'm on the way home. I'm driving. I stop for gas like a lunatic. And I text my son and I go, dude, do you want to go get wings when I get home? That's how much I was lying to myself. I was feeling a pain I've never felt before. I'm pretty sure I knew what it was, but I wasn't sure, and I figured I could just ride it out, you know? I get home, and I tell my wife, who's a nurse, we think, right? I go, babe, I think I'm having a heart attack. And she's like, well, you're probably just dehydrated. It's been hot today. Why don't you just sit down? Let me watch you for a minute. I couldn't sit still. I'm pacing around the house. Next thing you know, I'm kneeling on the floor, my chest in the cushions of the couch, and I'm moaning. She goes, oh, man, this looks serious. And she calls my son. He goes, come down here, plan A. I go, plan A? He comes downstairs with a box. And in the box is a little bottle of nitroglycerin tablets. I'm like, you had nitroglycerin tablets on standby? Mm-hmm. She goes, look at your big behind. This was inevitable. We knew it was coming. We knew it was going to happen. Put this under your tongue. Shut up and sit down. So I sit down. 5 minutes later, I feel like $1 million. I'm like, all right, great. I'm glad that's over. I'm going to go take a shower. She's like, no, you're not. My son grabs me, throws me in the car. We run off to the hospital. It was like 8 minutes away. And it was weird walking in going, hey, this is strange, but I think I'm having a heart attack. Can you guys check me out a little bit? And she goes, sure, you know. And they confirmed it. 2 in the morning, Sunday, you had a heart attack. So I'm sitting there, and I'm calling everybody. I'm freaking out, right? And but I was cool. I was relaxed. They had me on blood thinners. Everything was cool. Monday morning, the nurse comes in. And this is, gets a little personal, guys. So it's just my story, right? And the nurse comes in. She goes, do you have any questions, Mr. Rodriguez? I was like, no. She goes, well, the tech is going to be in, and she's going to prep you for the procedure. I was getting a catheter, and they were going to find what the block was, right? And I don't know if you knew, but they go in through your groin. And I go, what do you mean prep you for the procedure? And she's like, you know, tighten things up a little bit. I'm like, can I do my own area? Is that a thing? Because she's like, no, you're on blood thinners. And she sheared me like a young lamb. It was a nightmare. And I was embarrassed because I was married almost 30 years and at the time. And it was very cold in that room. It was so cold in that room, sir. You know what I'm talking about. And I'm probably never going to come back. I'm not going to be invited back. So they wheeled me into the cath lab. And I say, hey, how's everybody doing today? And as soon as I said hello, splash, they hit me with a mop full of ice cold antiseptic at ground zero. And I'm like, wow, is there enough ice in that? That's a little spicy. Is that supposed to sting? She's like, yeah, there's, you know, you're going to be okay. So I'm laying there. I'm trying to cool it off by blowing, like, but my breath was hitting my belly and shooting up this way. The lady's bangs are moving. I'm like, this is horrible. Anyway, make a long story short, they found one blockage at 90%, and they put one stent in. But I'm fine. I'm fine now. So thank you. Thank you. I'll say this. You like to be short, you know, politics and differences of religion and who other people are sleeping with. Just, you know, just be polite to everybody. I don't know. Would you say that's a fair thing? So, you know, change your perspective and try not to stress out because it can be gone like that tomorrow. So try to, I don't know where this is going, but this is the weirdest thing. I'm talking to you guys. Bunch of young people in here looking at me like 30 years of marriage. They have no idea what I'm talking about. They want to eat some pizza and play some Call of Duty or something. I don't know what's going on, but I'm down for whatever, especially the pizza. Are we good with the judging, or? Okay, wow, thank you. Thank you. Guys, thank you so much. Change your perspective. I'm Carlos Rodriguez. Enjoy the rest of the program. Have a great night. Thank you so much. Thank you, boss.
Thank you, Carlos Rodriguez. We were just on pins and needles the whole time throughout that whole comedy routine. Let me tell you, that was great. It's got to be tough to make a comedy routine like two generations below you, right? I mean, sometimes the humor, sometimes it hits, sometimes it doesn't. But no, I think everybody enjoyed it. Did you enjoy Carlos' act? Yeah, that was good. Good job, Carlos. Wonderful. Yeah, you know, as a university professor, we learn a lot from watching comedians. Let me tell you, we learn a lot how to handle an audience, how to wait for the laugh. Sometimes it comes, sometimes it never comes. But it's hard work, and Carlos did a great job. It looks like we have some results from the judging panel. I'm going to hand it over here to Chris Blake on behalf of the judging panel. We, just so you know, everybody watching, we've gotten tons of messages saying that the click to vote thing wasn't working, and apparently it wasn't. So we did a little workaround in an entrepreneurial way, and we posted in the chat in the live stream where you can write in who you want to vote for. So we have somebody hand tallying the votes right now, and we're going to do that workaround, and we're going to find out who got the most votes. We don't have the results yet. It feels like election night and presidential election or something, but they're coming in. Let me tell you, they're coming in, and we're waiting for them to come in. We will have results, hopefully, by tonight. But we have some formal results right now, so I'm going to ask Chris to please come up here and report on behalf of the judging panel, maybe introduce the judges, and thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. So it was definitely a tough deliberation. All the teams were great, and we had a tough time out there. I think we arm wrestled a few times and finally came to some conclusions. But I do want to thank our judges. So we had Raima Henderson. She was one of our judges. Allison Swagler-Webb from the Foundation, and also Mark Bernsteel from the Alabama Power Foundation. So they were the judges along with myself. And so Now, without any further ado, let's get the teams announced. So we'll start with our third place team, and they get a cash prize of $2,000 for their work, and that goes to Iron City Experiences.
Would you guys like to say something about the win?
Yeah, just thank you for everyone's votes and especially the judges. We had a blast working on this project, and it was great how our team worked together. And I can speak for the group that it changed all of our view about how we look at startups, how we look at how they can impact the city. So it was a great experience, and thank you again for your deliberation and results.
Harvester.
Congratulations.
I think I would like to thank, well, you're the team leader. So
you're the team leader.
It's been an awesome ride. Thanks to my team. They've done an awesome job. I was just there to like help guide in a little bit, and they were creative. They were awesome. Special shout out to Brian and Layton. Y'all did awesome. And then supporting roles, y'all did. It was an awesome experience. Thank you so much for letting us do this album of power. We really appreciate it so much.
I hope you appreciated our skit. We tried to be a little bit different than a traditional pitch. And second place feels really awesome. So thank you.
All right.
Great job.
Yep.
Now, I'll be honest, you guys can't see this at home. They were just happy to get some pizza, but okay, they'll take $1,000.
All right, friends, big smiles. Ready, and 1, 2, and 3. Last one. Great job, friends. All right, congratulations, friends. Great job.
Congrats.
All right, congratulations.
Good job. Great job.
All righty. Well, we're to the top spot now.
Top spot. But before you announce the top winner, again, congratulations to everyone. I know how hard it is sometimes to work with a team. And then when everyone has bright ideas and all of it means something, I'm really just talking just to just drag it out. Okay, go ahead. They're looking at me like, yeah, shut up.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So without further ado, the number one with a $5,000 prize goes to RE Form.
RE Form, come up and get your top prize. Congratulations.
All right, congratulations.
Thank you so much. We purely don't have any words. I've been honored to work with these amazing group of individuals. We've had a lot of ideas come up, and everything that we formed just kind of integrated one together. It wouldn't be possible with a lot of you here, especially Dr. Murphy, with his guidance and support. My parents are in the back supporting me from day one. And of course, the judges and my other teammates. It's truly been an honor to work with you guys and get to know you guys on this level. So thank you so much.
All right, congratulations.
Yep. I missed so many votes.
Okay.
Dr. Murphy took my microphone, but you can keep it. It's your event. Chris, thank you so much for all that you have done for this program. Thank you so much, Dr. Murphy, for allowing me to come and see. I mean, it's just exciting to know so many people from all around the world choose to become educated by people like you here in Birmingham, and that they're going to go out and make the world a better place.
That's right. And you know, we have one more announcement to make, the People's Choice Award.
Oh, that's right.
Which they're madly tallying right now. So everybody, we don't know who it is yet. There's...
It's funny, in the electronic age, and we're doing this by hand.
Yeah.
We're counting the votes by hand. Not a job for a comedian to do, so yeah. I'll just stand over here while someone else is doing the math.
So, Eunice, who did you like among the five teams?
Oh, you know what? Let's see. I had something I was really impressed with each team. I really enjoyed watching them collaborate. I loved when they were passing the mics. I even liked when they got nervous and then found their way. Like, even on the winning team, the young man, it was like he couldn't find it, and then once he found it, he killed it. Mm-hmm. So it's always exciting to see people kind of push themselves to the limit. So I would say every team was my favorite, because it takes a lot to get up here and do that.
Right, and you know that team that won, they had that young man, he was a little bit nervous there, and mm-hmm. then he brought it all together.
Yeah.
Do you think he did that on purpose because he wanted to get a sympathy support?
Oh, that's a good idea.
Because that would have been dope if he did that.
I don't know, you would have to ask the judges. It's like, did the struggle at the end.
I know, that was amazing. Yeah, I see you.
I know we're just killing time. I want to shout out Carlos as a stand-up comedian. This is a tough crowd, but 31 years of marriage. I've never been married. So impressive, 22 years of marriage, but I do want to tout my own longest relationship is 18.1 years. That's with Sprint, but still, it's on the top of my bill.
As an employee or a customer?
A customer. Customer with Sprint. It's my longest relationship. But shouts out to Carlos.
Oh, my gosh.
That's hard to do, to be in a room full of young people who are trying to win money and wait on pizza. they set you up, Carlos. They set you up.
Man, you did great, man.
Better you than me.
That's how we roll here at UAB. We put you through the ringer. I mean, not just the students, but even the guests, even the comedian guests.
Okay, they're still counting.
They're over there
That's
furiously counting,
everybody. That's the last piece of
everybody.
Business we have is the people's choice,
right? That's right. That's right. How's the pizza, guys? How's the pizza? Yeah, is it? Oh, good. Okay.
They were too nervous to eat.
I know. I can never eat if I'm going to talk.
Okay, fine. I'll tell a joke.
Okay, there we go.
No, but as a professional comedian, one of my favorite things in the world to do is to tell bad jokes. I mean, some people call them dad jokes, but I actually will sometimes just Google horrible jokes. And anytime I have a microphone and I need to kill time, hold my paper.
Yes, ma'am.
It's my time to shine. All right. What do you call... Sorry, I'm already tickling myself, yeah. What do you call a belt made out of watches? A waste of time.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness.
Okay, I set it up. I said bad jokes.
Ooh.
Okay, what does a nosy pepper do? What does a nosy pepper do? Be jalapeno business?
Oh, my God.
No? Okay. All right. What do you call a singing computer? Adele.
Singing or sinking?
Listen, I'm trying to help you out. yeah, that's kind of what I do for fun. What kind of clothes... does a house wear? A dress. A dress. All right, I know.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, I know y'all are eating, but have y'all heard about that new movie, Constipation? It hasn't come out yet. Okay, I'll stop. I'm probably making it harder for him to count.
Hurry up and count, man. Oh,
keep
man.
Going. Come on.
Keep going.
Keep us going. No, this is good. This is good.
Carlos, what you got? I know you got some. Let me think. Oh, man. You know, I don't trust stairs because they're always up to something.
Mm.
No? Okay. Look at how y'all just looking at me like, wow. I came here, I was having a really great career when I got here, and this is it now. Watching college students eat pizza. All right, well, let's see.
No, this is great. This is great. I was just walking outside the other day. Saw a dog walking down the street, and I said, woof, 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 woof. And he barked right back at me.
Are you kidding me? I could have been telling another joke for that.
I'm trying to make you look good.
All right, don't think too hard about this. There's a plane, and it's been loaded with 500 very special bricks, but when the plane lands, there's only 499 bricks. What happened to the other brick? Don't think too hard. It fell off the plane. I said, don't think too hard. Okay, let's move on. What are the three steps to put an elephant inside a refrigerator? Three steps to put an elephant inside the refrigerator. Okay, and not everyone at one time. All right, you open the door, you put the elephant in, and you close the door. I think y'all are thinking too hard. Join me. Don't think at all.
All right. I got another one.
Wait. What are the four steps to put a giraffe in a refrigerator? Open the door. Take the elephant out. Put the giraffe in. Close the door. All right, so the lion is the king of the jungle. He was having a big party. He invited everyone. Every animal showed up except for one. Who didn't show up? Thank you, the giraffe. He's in the refrigerator. There was one human invited, Susie, but she had to jump into this alligator-infested swamp and make it to the other side, and she did, and she made it alive. How was she able to do that? Thank you, okay. Mr. High School. The alligators were at the party, but she still died when she made it to the other side. Why did she die?
She drowned.
She got hit in the head with the brick that fell off the plane.
Oh my God. All right.
And you're welcome.
Good job, Eunice Elliott. Eunice Elliott,
perfect
everybody.
Perfect timing.
Perfect. All right, the ballots have come in, and...
And this is for $1,000, right?
Okay. It's for $1,000, and we have a tie.
Ooh. He's so nervous at his counting.
We don't do recounts. These weren't mailed in. We hand counted. There was an audit. And I'd like to congratulate Steel City Harvesters and Iron City Experiences.
Oh, super cool.
Congratulations. We want to thank everybody. If you're still out there, I think I could hear the computers clicking off
while we were
up here talking. But I'm going to hand it back to Eunice, our MC for this evening. And thank you. Thank you, Chris Blake, Alabama Power Foundation. If you want to take us out, Eunice, this has been a magical, wonderful evening in the Magic City. Thank you to all the students. You make us proud. We are very proud of you. You all did wonderful. Have a good night. Eunice Elliott, everybody.
Exactly what he said. Thank you so much, Dr. Murphy. Hey, young folks, please keep doing what you have been doing. You are our future. We're so excited about everything that you're going to bring to the table, not just to Birmingham, but to the world. Congratulations. Thank you so much again to the judges. Thank you to the sponsors. Thank you, Dr. Murphy, for having me. Thank you to Carlos for doing the comedy that I didn't do. And you guys stay safe and good night. Yay.